you like what you have and you wish you could tell yourself what you want to hear. But you can't, so you keep to yourself and you try to ignore what you can't anymore. And you find that the tears come down to something as you fall out in the nothing.
My name's John Nine. I'm one of the senior programmers here at the festival, and excited about the panel program that we've put together for the whole festival. I urge you to take a look online or in the film guide. There's a lot of fantastic events. We try to put together the people that we think are most interesting as they appear in various films in various forms. Great panel this afternoon that I encourage you to come to and throughout the rest of the week. The idea behind Cinema Cafe has always been to kind of start the day with something a little original, an odd pairing perhaps. And when we were watching films for the festival this year, One of the things that struck us about having David Gordon Green back here and about Dave Grohl's film Sound City was that they really reflect on the notion of independence across different art forms and what that means. And so this was kind of a discussion that we thought would be really, really interesting. I want to thank our partners in this series, Times Talks, and I want to thank the panelists for coming, Dave and David, and I'm going to turn it over to Carol Day from the New York Times. Thanks.
Thank you, John. We're honored and delighted to be at the Sundance Film Festival again this year and to have Times Talks at the Cinema Cafe. We're live here in Park City, and we're live around the world on the web. The New York Times and nytimes.com cover movies like we cover the world. And we salute the work of the festival in creating opportunities for new filmmakers and the chance for all of us to experience the creativity and craft of storytellers from around the globe. Our guests this morning are two extremely creative and passionate independent filmmakers. One is an internationally renowned musician who is presenting his first work as a documentary filmmaker here at the festival. The other is a Sundance veteran whose directorial debut won Best First Film Award from the New York Film Critics Circle. Both have films premiering at the festival this year, the documentary Sound City and the comedy drama Prince Avalanche. I know we're in for a compelling conversation led by our moderator. Most of the time during the film festival and awards season, you know her as the carpetbagger. Your nytimes.com guide to the red carpet and the festival season, to the news and the nonsense of the awards. And in the Carpetbagger blog, she and her colleagues take a look at films and the people who make them and star in them, trends and breakthroughs, and moves by the moguls. When she's not the carpetbagger, she's a cultural reporter for the Times, and she chronicles the changing creative landscape of Detroit. She's been embedded on an eco-art barge. She's toured with punk bands, and she's profiled everyone from Tina Fey to Ghostface Killa. Please join me in welcoming the carpetbagger, Milena Rysik, and our very special guests, Dave Grohl and David Gordon Green.
Hey, everybody.
Good morning.
Thanks for coming. We're going to chat for a while, and then we'll have some time for questions towards the end here. So welcome, guys. I don't know if people know this, but you guys just met like 2 minutes ago over there.
Yeah, we bonded really quickly.
Absolutely.
I really like him.
He's David, and I'm Dave. So
I want to start by talking about, you guys both had your premieres already. I don't know if people here probably know this, but I don't know if people watching at home live on the internet do that. A lot of times when movies premiere here, nobody has seen them. You know, big crowds haven't seen them, and sometimes your cast and crew haven't seen them together. So let's start by talking about, what does it feel like to watch the movie with the people involved in it for the first time?
Well, the people involved are very interesting, and then the people that are uninvolved are very interesting. So, you know, you always get the butterflies in your stomach when you unleash it on a lot of people at once. You know, with the movie I'm here with, Prince Avalanche, I'd probably shown it to probably 10 of my friends and a few folks along the way, but had never seen it in front of a stranger. And then on top of all the strangers that are going to judge you, you got like my mom and dad came, and like there was an ex-girlfriend in the audience, and that was weird. You know, so and then some of the, you know, the movie has very few actors, but one of the lead actors had not seen the movie. I'd refused to let him see it until he could actually see it with the crowd, so he wasn't going to be so critical on himself, and he could see people kind of in their reaction to his performance, which we were really, really excited about. But as a filmmaker, I'm always nervous to see where it goes, and what, you know, every audience is different too, and especially when you travel around, go internationally with your movie, and you see some cultures that think certain things are funny, and others you're just looking at them and say, you made a comedy, you have no idea what anyone's laughing at.
Germany.
I'm headed there in 2 weeks.
That's what he was saying backstage, that Berlin, maybe they're not the audience for stoner comedies. Pineapple Express didn't necessarily go over
there. It wasn't a big hit in Berlin. No.
Sorry, any Germans, if you're watching. And Dave, what did
you
think?
Well, with Sound City, I mean, I'm telling the story of a place that was really special to a lot of different musicians. And the message of the movie is something that everybody's really passionate about. So when we had our premiere on Friday, it was 2:30 in the afternoon, and then we were having a gig that night where Stevie Nicks and John Fogerty and Rick Springfield, we were all going to play together at this club. And first of all, I was terrified that they were going to see the movie, hate it, and not show up to the gig. But then all of them were so emotional. Like, everybody just cried. You know, I was telling the story of their time at the studio, and I was talking about music and the human connection and things that we all feel really deeply, we feel are things that are really important to us as musicians. And so I was terrified that Stevie Nicks would think that, you know, the lighting was wrong or whatever. But fortunately, everyone loved it, and then we had a great gig. But it's, you know, I've never made a movie, so as we were making Sound City, I was convinced, like, this is the greatest movie of all time. And I kind of felt like I was making it for myself, because it's the story's really close to me, and the people in the movie are very close to me. And so it was almost like paying tribute to my friends. And I wasn't really too... at first, I didn't really take the audience into consideration until I showed it to a friend and had that feeling of showing it to someone else for the first time. And then I just thought, this is the worst piece of shit I've ever seen in my entire life. So, and then, you know, of course, we turned it into something really special.
Yeah, let's talk about that, because when you talked at the beginning, at the premiere, you said, I'm a director, and you sounded surprised.
It wasn't meant to be the movie, really. The story comes from a studio that Nirvana recorded at 20 years ago. It was a total dump, but it had a room a little bit bigger than this room that, for whatever reason, just sounded magical, and a recording console that was custom ordered, one of a kind. There's only one of them in the world that everyone considered to be one of the best boards in the world. And that changed my life, because had it not been for that board in that room, I don't know if I would be here right now. I think that the people and the places where albums are made are just as instrumental to the albums as the instruments that are played on the album. So they closed last year, and I offered to buy the board, and I was reunited with this piece of equipment that represents something huge to me, and I thought I'd pay tribute to that just by making a short film. And then I reached out to everyone from Rick Springfield to Neil Young to Rick Rubin to Trent Reznor, and everyone agreed to jump on board, because they believed in what we were trying to say, which is, you know, we were trying to show people that the human element and that human connection when musicians play together is where real magic happens. So it just all kind of came together, and I didn't know what a director was supposed to do or what a director does.
Do you know now?
Well, I mean, the other day I was talking to someone about it, like, I'm not really a guitar player, I'm faking it, you know? I never took lessons to do that. I'm not a drummer, I never took lessons to do that. I fucking hold my sticks backwards, I play wrong. So, but it's this, I think the same thing applies to a filmmaker. Why do what you're supposed to do, or why have someone tell you that that's not really how it's done? Because why would you want to do it like everyone else? And in music, it's the people that don't take lessons and do the wrong thing that become Jimi Hendrix or Keith Moon. And you listen to that and you think, oh my God, you never heard anything like it, because they were never trying to be anyone but themselves. So all I had to do was tell the story of this incredible studio that was really close to me and talk to my heroes about music. It was really easy.
I think it's got a good point, though, about a director just kind of gets to unleash really talented people on the world, which, or on a subject matter. You know, you kind of wrap your head around something, and then you get a great DP and a great editor, and you light it really well. But, you know, you're not really typically doing all of that. And some people are. There's those, you know, one-man bands of movies as well. But I've always looked at the movie making process just in a very similar fashion to a band. I mean, and particularly with Mike, the crew I use, we went to film school together, and Tim Moore's been my DP on 9 movies now. Richard Wright's been my production designer forever, and you know, we really look at it like a band of filmmakers that go around, and we just play different instruments. And for me, the idea of being a director is kind of almost the conductor of, like, let's just get great people in a room and try different things. And when you're with people that you trust, and watching Dave's movie was kind of I was emotionally connected to that movie just through my own relating my work process to his work process and to the enthusiasm of collaboration, because if we weren't excited about the collaborations, we'd be, you know, nerds sitting in a dark room by ourselves writing poetry or painting, you know, wonderful paintings. But the idea of the electricity in the room, of what happens when you get people that you like to focus in on a target and try to create something is pretty incredible.
Well, I hope that you guys have all seen Sound City, but we have a clip so we can play it and get a sense of what you guys are talking about here.
When we showed up at Sound City, what is this place? Because I don't know that we can make a record in here.
When you walk into Sound City, you either love it or you hate it. It
looks kind of dumpy.
Brown shag carpet on the wall. That's the kind of thing that you would do to your van.
But walking down the hallway and seeing all of those platinum records on the wall, that's what I'm talking about.
Tom Petty. Fleetwood
Mac. Neil Young, man.
Cheap Trick.
Chili Peppers. Pat
Benatar. Guns N' Roses.
Nine Inch Nails.
Foreigner. Rap.
Johnny Cash.
Metallica.
Dude, how many amazing albums have been made there?
Who chose Sound City because Nevermind was recorded there?
This guy, Rupert Neve, designed these next-generation consoles.
There's only 4 like this in the world.
There's something about the Neve sound.
It's a pretty badass console.
When you came to work at Sound City, it was a tape-based studio. You knew what you were getting.
Sound City was a place where real men went to make records.
All during the 80s, you listen to one of these stations where they played rock and roll.
7 or 8 out of 10 songs were recorded at Sound City.
I was wondering whoever used the board after us, if they had a burning sensation the next morning. Then they'd know we were there.
Other studios started to shift.
Everything's got to be digital.
Now you can record audio into the computer.
I heard some young guy in a band say, you don't have to practice anymore. Or you just slice it up in the computer and it comes out perfectly.
Sound City, it just couldn't keep up.
Started selling off the gear in Studio B.
I thought that board would just go straight to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
I'm trying to move on, but it's been hard.
Like many things, there's no bookstore, there's no music store, and there's no Sound City.
In this age of technology, where you can manipulate anything, how do we retain that human element?
Let's rock, let's play, let's record.
Be true to yourself and make the music that you love.
Chemistry is something that happens between people.
The conversation became something much bigger. How do we keep music to sound like people?
It sort of like evolves until it hits this point and maybe goes.
Applause for the trailer. This is fun.
So did you do all those interviews yourself?
Yeah. Yeah, I forewarned everyone. I made sure that, you know, when I emailed one of the heroes of mine, I said, you know, I'm no Barbara Walters, but we can just talk about music. And every one of these musicians comes from the same place. In the beginning of the movie, I talk a little bit about, there's a little narration where I say we were just kids, and we had nothing to lose, and nowhere to call home, but we had these songs and we had these dreams, so we just threw it all into the back of an old van and just started driving. And that can apply to every single musician in the film. Every single person did the same thing. So everyone was just as passionate about this as I am. And because of that, it was really fun. And I mean, I had these inspired conversations with Trent Reznor about technology, or with Jim Keltner, a legendary drummer, about feel, you know, or Neil Young about analog and the feeling of jamming for the first time with someone. And so, I mean, it was amazing. It would, I mean, had there been no movie, my life would be better just because of those conversations, you know.
So you've said that this is the most important thing you've done.
I think so. Yeah, I think so. I mean, people think that that's a silly thing to say because of all the bands that I've been in and all of, like, Nirvana and what that...
I've heard of them.
How that affected music. What's that?
I said I've heard of them.
Yeah. We're pretty good. But you know, it's when you're making albums and you're in a band, you're sort of... in a way, it's almost like a selfish practice. You know, like you make songs and you make music and you do that so that people will think that you're great. And the intention of Sound City was the opposite of that. It was for other people to want to do that themselves, you know. I mean, we wanted to inspire another generation of people to fall in love with music like we did. It's not even about how many people buy the movie or how many people get a Sound City hat or a t-shirt. I would just like everyone to see it so they can understand what it is when musicians, that feeling that musicians get when they play with each other, because it's available to everybody. You don't need anything but another human being to make that happen. And yeah.
Right, so you're trying to capture some of the serendipity of creativity, which is a thing that's sort of easier and harder to harness now that everybody has the technological tools. It's something that's applying to the music industry, it's applying to the film industry too. David, can you talk a little bit about how the handcraftedness of movies is something that you think about as you're making? Because you've done studio films, indie films, the sort of gamut. Are you looking to get some kind of that same creativity, that serendipity, that feeling?
I think it's a very, a very similar process, and it's always trying to tap into something. And every project I always approach kind of, you know, every project's its own unique thing, just like every album is its own unique, or, you know, you could even break it down into songs. But movies for me, you know, they're always evolving. I wake up and I've just got a different feeling than I had the day before, and that may be in the middle of a movie, and then I feel like, okay, I'm going to take a left turn here and then try to figure it out just because it feels right. Or I do a lot of improvisation on my movies with the actors, and so I'll talk through, you know, the camera's rolling, and I'll throw an idea at an actor, and he'll run with it while we're rolling. You know, I'm not taking him aside and going through a lot of textbook rehearsals and intellect to it. It's really just like jazz. It's you get, you know, and it can drive the, you know, the guy operating the boom mic crazy because he doesn't know where to aim it. But, you know, if you have a team that knows how to roll with your instincts, and they can kind of, at this point, you know, my sound mixer's reading my mind, and my cameraman's two steps ahead of where my brain is, and he knows where to anticipate. So you kind of have that kind of a sync and a groove, and I use a very similar process on my dramatic films that I do on my comedies. And this recent movie, I really tried to blend both of those worlds and all of the processes of my last several movies combined to try to take what I loved about the experiences and strip away all the logistics. So this latest movie is very minimal comparatively to a lot of the work I've done, because I wanted to see what we could do by minimizing our band. Instead of having a crew of 400 and spending, you know, $4 million a day, you know, we had a crew of 10 in a van, and no one had a trailer, and we had one camera and no lights. And we went out and filmed Paul Rudd and Emile Hirsch running around in a burnt-down forest for 16 days with a 60-page script. And so, you know, you don't know what you're getting into. Everybody just, I mean, surprisingly, everybody enthusiastically jumps on board and works for donuts and knows that something weird's going to happen. And so why not go for it?
So what were the weird things that happened?
I mean, my life is the weirdest thing. It really is this. Like, you get guys with a good sense of humor and a great work ethic. You know, everybody's crazy, so everybody's got their little tempers, their tantrums, and their, you know, buttons that you don't want to push or that you do. You know, and sometimes those can be really effective to tap into, and actually they can be really beautiful, creative devices. And that's why a lot of weirdos are in this room, because we like strange things and we like to create things, and we have minds that work a little less mathematically, or we can translate math into music, or we can, you know, our brains can work in interesting ways, or we can appreciate brains that work in interesting ways. And so by getting those people together of some sort of a unique design, and again, just letting it go and letting everybody bring their ability to the table. I always say that, you know, with movies, there's filmmakers that are shooting for perfection. Stanley Kubrick is a perfectionist. David Fincher, a perfectionist. You know, there's these guys, and some of my favorites and the greatest filmmakers of all time are perfectionists, but I really, I would be terrible at doing anything perfect. So I'm about momentum and jumping right into it. And sometimes that's premature, and sometimes I'm, you know, chasing the bus, trying to get it all together before it runs me over. But I'm really about the adrenaline and the uncertainty and the opportunity of the moment, and letting it go crazy. So I'm the momentumist, not the perfectionist.
The momentumist. I'm going to steal that. So, but that's one of the hallmarks.
It's a Scrabble word.
That's one of the hallmarks, really, of indie filmmaking. Sometimes you've got these limitations, and people, when I'm here at Sundance talking to filmmakers, and they often say that having a 16-day shoot and no budget, you know, it's tough, but it makes things more interesting. And you guys both worked sort of in...
You know, I got to say that what you just said applies to music as well. Like, one of the things about technology that makes music kind of complicated is that your options are limitless, and then you can fuck with things forever and ever, and you'll wind up beating something to death rather than just walking into a room, hitting record, being restricted to 24 or 16 tracks, and having a song in 2 hours, because sometimes you could pull it out like that. Restriction really does, I think, does help creativity a lot.
But that said, what were the challenges, though? For, I mean, 16 days in a forest in Texas. I mean, first of all, was it really hot? Like, what were the challenges of making?
Well, it's things like rain. It rains one day, and you shot half of a scene the day before, and all of a sudden it's going to be raining. So are you going to cut between one actor in the, you know, broad daylight, sun shining bright, and the other actor it's raining on it? Maybe that could actually be kind of cool. So we did a little of that. But we just try to kind of find little opportunities. Mother Nature's always throwing us curveballs, and the whole movie, you know, we only had the sunshine as our primary lighting source, and so it's shooting, it's finding ways to block the actors where the sun's going to be our friend, rather than in the place that necessarily we conceived or the art director had put the, you know, had designed the set. So it's really kind of reconceiving it to do what's in our favor for efficiency, and works creatively. And a lot of times we'd be facing a crazy time crunch and weren't going to be able to complete a scene. So we're like, well, let's just try a version that we can just do it in one shot and do this one little crazy thing, and maybe it'll work. And maybe if it doesn't, then screw it, we'll come back tomorrow and try to do it properly. But I've very rarely in my life even done a reshoot, because I think those instant ideas and the craziest way to reinvent something on the spur of the moment have 9 times out of 10 in my life just been totally interesting ways to go about it, because they were less thoughtful. And I like sometimes the noble failures and going for something unique, even if it doesn't necessarily work, and even exhibiting that when it wouldn't be what you would have done if you had more time to design it with a little bit more of a confident hand. You know, in Prince Avalanche, in the script, it'd be a coyote eating a raccoon run over, a roadkill on the side of the road, and it'd be in the script. And then, you know, a coyote, you have to get an animal wrangler, and you have to pay them $1,200 a day, and then for a proper coyote to be shipped in from West Texas, then it was going to be another $2,000. So we found a lady that owned a skunk and thought it would be funny to come meet Paul Rudd. So and then we put a turtle shell. We got a turtle shell at a thrift store for 50 cents, and we smashed it and put gummy bears in it. And then just had the skunk, because the skunk's like gummy bears, which is weird. But so we had a skunk eating a smashed turtle, you know, and it cost $6 instead of $6,000. And so that, and to me, when I'm watching the scene and you kind of watch this kind of abstract, obscure, strange thing happening, it's so much more absurd and interesting than if you saw something as you know, as we do every day when we're driving down the highway and see a coyote eating a, you know, raccoon. Gummy bears, they are pretty good.
Well, you guys are both established in your careers. Do you feel like you have to kind of add in something that allows you to be nimble this way, like the challenge of shooting in 16 days or the challenge of making a documentary rather than a music video, for example?
That's a good question.
You know, when I wanted to have performance in the film so that we could demonstrate a lot of the things that we were talking about in the beginning. If we're talking about feel, or we're talking about composition, or we're talking about connection and conversation between musicians. I thought, you know, to talk about it is one thing, but to really do it and show people what it's like, that speaks volumes. You know, when you see some musicians that have never met come together and make a song in a few hours. So I had this idea that, okay, I'm going to assemble these different configurations of musicians that might not know each other, and get them in a studio and have one day to write and record a song. And logistically, it was kind of a nightmare, and we got as close as we could. But I was real. That was, to me, that was going to be the experiment or the challenge. Like, I was this close to getting Barry Manilow together with Weezer. It was like, it was so, so close.
Sequel.
What's that?
Sequel.
Prequel. Yeah, I mean, I feel like it's exciting. It's when you do things on the fly like that, that's when, you know, it, like writing music, writing songs, the best ones happen in 3.5 minutes. When something just rolls off because the more you manipulate your original intention, like kind of the farther away you get from what, like that real source. And so, yeah, it's fun. And it, you know, logistically to make some of these things happen, whether it's getting a coyote on set or getting, you know, Stevie Nicks in the studio before 3 o'clock in the afternoon, it's like, it's fun.
David, your movie was actually inspired by another movie. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, it was Prince Avalanche is a remake of an Icelandic movie called Either Way that came out last year and did a lot of film festivals. And the genesis of this movie is really backwards. At first, I had a title that I had a dream of making a movie called Prince Avalanche, but I woke up before I realized what it was about. Which was really frustrating because I woke up, I was like, that's a kick-ass title for a movie. And now I've got to find a movie for it. And then I found this location. Actually, the guys that did the score for the movie, one of my regular composer, David Wingo, and then the band Explosions in the Sky all collaborated to do the music, to do the score. And so the drummer from Explosions and I were watching the Super Bowl, and he was telling me about this burnt-down state park that had been devastated in a forest fire. He said, you should go make a movie there. So I said, okay, I'll go make a movie there. So I went there the next day, literally, and said, I should make a movie here. This is cool. It should be called Prince Avalanche. What's it about? And then I go up to New York, and I was talking to one of my art director buddies. I was shooting a commercial up there, and I said, I got this cool location and a cool title. What's the movie that I can do there? And I said, I just want like two people and a very minimal character piece and design something that's just, I'll get two great actors and really strip away what I don't like about movies, and we'll just like let these guys go. He's like, oh, my friend just worked on a movie in Iceland called Either Way. You should just remake that. I said, is it good? He said, I don't know. I haven't seen it. And so I tracked it down, and like, I'm watching it on an airplane. 10 minutes in, I was like, I totally should remake this. It's exactly what I was looking to do. It works perfectly in this place. And so, you know, with a handshake of the producers and director of the original movie, who just thought I was ridiculous for wanting to remake their movie. But I had a very personal spin I wanted to put onto it and really put my fingerprint on it and do something interesting with their architecture. But, you know, it was a really amazing process because you spend so much time in traditional studio Hollywood movies where you go through your 6 months or 6 years of development and rewrites and, you know, meetings and talking about making movies, which is kind of cool sometimes, but it gets old. And then you spend your 6 months making the movie, and then your year and a half editing the movie, and you know, and that can be awesome and educational and very fulfilling and really ambitious, and you learn a lot. But it takes a long time, and that's like, you know, you blink and a year and a half, your life is gone, and that's for this chapter, for this project. But with Avalanche, the idea hit me at the Super Bowl, the day after the Super Bowl, and we were sound mixing in July, and it was just a really amazingly, aggressively, energetically, just go get them, let's do it. And we did it short and sweet and quiet and had a hell of a great time making it. So it becomes its own unique process and in product that way. It's very raw and unpolished. And I think a lot of that, you know, kind of, I mean, you could parallel it to like the garage band approach to making music that, you know, sometimes if you drop the mic or, you know, you get a little feedback and sound blows out, it becomes the beauty of it. And, you know, this movie's full of lens flares and things like that people really try to iron out a lot of times or really protect the lighting or make the actors look good or find the perfect close-up. And this was just about, you know, getting out there and seeing what we found.
Oh, we have a clip. Do you want to just give a little thumbnail of the backstory? I mean, the story of the movie?
The story of the movie is Paul Rudd's character, Alvin, is dating a woman, and her brother is kind of this screw-up kid played by Emile Hirsch. And so Paul has agreed to hire, employ Emile to come work for him on a road crew. It's the two of them cleaning up the road, painting stripes on a road after a forest fire has ravaged Central Texas. So it's these two guys basically talking trash to each other on the road for an hour and a half.
Oh, so just toss me the keys and I'll pick you up on Monday. You need any help with the camp setting up?
Sure.
Really?
You know what? Don't worry about it. I'll get it. Oh. But you do have to do one thing. I want you to mail that for me, all right? It's for your sister, and there's money in there, so be careful with it.
Sweet. How much?
None.
Of your business.
Oh, come on. How much?
Hundreds of dollars.
Why doesn't she get a job? Why do you send her money?
She's got a lot going on.
No, she doesn't. She stays at home and talks on the phone and chews gum.
Yeah, she's raising her child.
Who's in school all day?
Drop it.
So you just take off and bust your ass and send money back home?
It's called love.
I don't get it.
Yeah, well, you know what? You don't have to get it, all right? All you have to do is mail that letter. Oh, and one more thing. Lance.
What?
Have fun.
Thanks.
Did you have to convince Paul Rudd to grow that mustache, or was that natural?
It was his idea. You know, it's the beauty of getting actors that don't mind looking a little ridiculous sometimes. I mean, the movie takes place in 1988, and so it has this kind of absurdity from that, from an art direction and character standpoint. But yeah, I think that was Paul's mandate.
But you thought of these two characters as facets of yourself, right, when you were writing?
Yeah, I'm very self-indulgent as a writer, and when I'm adapting the Icelandic movie, I'm literally sitting at my computer watching that, and then pushing pause, and then and plagiarizing it. but then that's how I kind of get it all out there, and then I go back and I talk through the situations and these characters, but I always become very self-indulgent and kind of become the characters. I have a really hard time writing a character I don't identify with, so they both become me. And it's me, you know. It's literally a conversation between me and me. And it's, and, you know, the easy thing to say would be, it'd be like the, you know, the uptight versions of me as Paul, and then the kind of loose and footloose and fancy free as Emile. But it's a little bit more complicated than that. I think it's too. I'm very childish in a lot of ways. I'm 37, but I feel like I'm 11 years old in terms of my energy and enthusiasm, but also in some of my sensitivity and pieces of myself that feel broken that I'm trying to always re-engineer or rejigger or pretend I'm more confident in something than I am, and all these kind of strange neuroses. And so I kind of found myself unintentionally in this movie particularly finding my voice in both of these guys, yelling at myself, playing devil's advocate with myself. Really, and it turned really, really trippy. So, but in terms of a communication with an actor, then we could kind of integrate them into the process, and Paul would be like, okay, I'm a little less like you here, and let me do something a little like this over here. You know, so it became a really kind of two-handed collaboration with each of these actors as we started making it less me and more our own creation. So a version of me kind of exists in this weird ethereal way, and I half the movie is things that I've said or heard someone say to me. And, you know, like there's a scene where an old truck driver drives by and Paul takes a cigar and smoking a cigar with him, and the old truck driver tells him he looks stupid, which, for me, when I was smoking a cigarette one time, and I was on a movie set of a friend of mine, and Sam Shepard came up to me and said, "You shouldn't smoke cigarettes." I said, "I know, it's bad for you." He's like, "No, you shouldn't, because you look stupid." And when Sam Shepard tells you you look stupid smoking a cigarette, it's extinguished. But so, I like to expose myself in my movies and really make, you know, so I watch that and just, you know, roll my eyes every time I think about the humiliation that...
Is it therapizing then to do that?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I don't think I could exist in a healthy way. And I don't think I was a very healthy person until I started making movies. Because it was interesting, because I grew up with a lot of friends that were great musicians. And I'd pick up a banjo or saxophone and try to whittle through something. But like, I never could click with the talent that these guys had. And until I really found what my, and I loved movies all my life, and I loved music, but movies always, and music to me seemed like accessible because I could save my paper out money and get a guitar. But I just would, then I would get it and I wouldn't be good at it.
And banjos and saxophones are really fucking hard to play.
Well, maybe I should start with something little.
Start harmonica, maybe.
Play the drums, man.
But so it just became like a thing that when I found I could do it, I became like, I literally just became a healthy person when I found that I could like find my voice and you know, and express myself in this way. It became something that made me feel less weird. And when you're growing up in Richardson, Texas and going to high school and everybody's looking at you just like, why is he dressed like that? And, you know, why does he say these things in class? And what does he, you know, this creative writing class is unacceptable, you know? So then all of a sudden, my unacceptability became, you know, my greatest asset. And I think that's really, it's really funny to see people that I grew up with now just like laughing at success. You know, it's just bizarre to them. And I like to be the unexpected.
Dave, did you have a similar experience? Did you ever think you could be anything other than a musician?
Drywaller. No, I mean, when I was a kid, I fell in love with the Beatles when I was maybe 7 or 8 years old. And my mother got me a guitar and a songbook that had these chord charts, and that's where I started, and I would play along with the albums, and that's where I learned about song structure and composition. Nobody really told me how it works. I would just listen to that, but I never thought that I would grow up and be a Beatle, all right? And by the time I was 12 years old, I grew up in Virginia, and it didn't seem like a career opportunity, you know. Music to me didn't seem like something that I could ever like pay the rent doing. It was just something that I felt like I needed to do. And when I was young, I didn't go to church. I had no religion. I just had these records. And so these albums were so important to me. Music was such a huge part of my life, and it was my escape, and it was my obsession. When I hear, even if I'm having a conversation with you and there's a song in the background, I can see the pattern of the arrangement going on in my head. And when I was a teenager playing really loud, noisy, crappy punk rock music, it was obvious that I was, you know, my shitty band was not going to storm the charts and knock Michael Bolton out of the way. It was like, we were just doing it because we felt the need to do it. We loved doing it. The reward really was just that we were doing it. It was its own reward. And it was the same way with Nirvana. You know, we didn't expect anything like that to happen, and it did. So, yeah, I mean, I think that every kid needs to know that they have that available to them, and that there is no right or wrong. And you know, I was friends with the stoners, I was friends with the jocks, I was friends with the geeks. I knew everybody, but I didn't feel like anybody really knew me, you know. And I felt perfectly comfortable in my own little world that I had created with music, and that's where you pull from when you write a movie or you write a song. I'm sure, you know, you pull everything from that place and you recycle life through yourself and your own twisted perspective on whatever it may be, love or death or whatever it is. And I liked being weird when I was young. Plus, I mean, in Springfield, Virginia, it's like I was listening to the fucking Bad Brains and the Dead Kennedys and, you know, like satanic death metal. And there was a church on every corner, you know, so I definitely didn't feel like, I would like spray paint things on the highway overpass that I spray painted once. I did these Anarchy A's, and I remember spray painting, your choice is no choice, change or be changed. I think I was like 14 years old, and everybody worked at the Pentagon. It was just like, what are you doing? But that's being a kid, right? You know, I look forward to my children fucking putting that in my face in 10 years, you know? I really encourage the weird. I think you have to encourage the weird.
Well, that's one of the interesting things about where we're at in terms of technology and how you can harness people's artistic vision or creativity. And one of the things I like about your movie is you definitely have a viewpoint about the sort of analog method of making music, but you're not against digital. There's a place for both. And there's a hopefulness about, I think.
Sure, yeah. I think that it's inspiring what you can do with technology now. I mean, when I was that little punk rock kid, in order for me to get anyone to hear my music, I'd have to go down to the crappy four-track studio in my friend's basement, record something that didn't sound that great, send it off to a pressing plant, they send back singles, I'd go to Kinko's and I'd make little covers and stuff the sleeves, and then I'd put a stamp on an envelope and I'd send it to someone for $3.50. That process has changed to recording something in your living room with state-of-the-art technology that sounds amazing, and the click of a button is distributed to the entire world, which is awesome. Like, that's anyone can do that. I think that's inspiring. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. The story of Sound City and technology, technology basically has made these wonderful old studios that I consider to be like museums or cathedrals, you know. They've become obsolete. You know, you can simulate or emulate what those studios are capable of in your living room. You might not capture the magic of those places, but so a lot of those studios are going under, and it's one of the reasons why technology is a big part of the Sound City movie, because it ultimately is the biggest reason why Sound City couldn't really survive. But also the conversation of the human element of music. You know, you can use your iPhone and record the busker in the subway and listen to it all day long, and that can change your life. And you can hear the humanity and what he's singing, or the emotion in his voice. So the device doesn't really matter. I think it's the content of the artist and where it comes from as a musician. Like, you don't rely on that shit to be a musician. Like, rely on yourself. You know, use that as an instrument. Use that as a tool, but don't rely on it. That's kind of what we're talking about.
Well, to bring it back to the filmmaking process a little bit, the same tools that you guys have in music makes shooting forever more possible in terms of digital. But I'm curious always for filmmakers how you choose your last shot, especially for Prince Avalanche. I don't want to spoil it if you guys haven't seen it, but tell me about, and for documentaries it's the same thing, because you know any story could go on forever, especially a documentary. So talk to me about how you chose what the final image, the final moment would be for the film.
That's a really tough question. Because it's very unrelated to the movie. It was just kind of in the process, and we had actually more of a traditional ending, and I'm not going to spoil anything. It's not like a movie with a secret ending or anything. It's just got a weird ending. And we had a traditional ending that was kind of scripted, but then when we were editing it, literally we didn't even get that far, because we just are putting it all together, and we have this little montage of life and elements of the world around these guys, and then all of a sudden, it's just like, oh, we should just be done now. Like, this should be it. This shot's just how to end it. It'd be amazing. And it's not about our characters, and it's not about our story, and that becomes the most powerful way to kind of show the universe around these guys rather than show the interior exposition of these guys. So to me, that just became, I mean, it's always an opportunity. Yeah, how you begin and how you end a movie is the most valuable thing, because if it begins, you know, boring or ugly or annoying or whatever it is, people just leave. And if you can end with that moment of that you're looking for, if it's triumph, if it's depression, if it's you know, some sort of catharsis, like whatever you're looking for, if you can end with that beat and really nail it, then that's what the audience is left with. And by having that impression surprise me, I thought it was even cooler, because it just revealed itself to me rather than me conceiving of it, designing of it, and saying, here you go. It just says, no, here I am, shut up and stop messing with it, David. You know?
Did you have a worry about how to start and end the movie, Dave?
You know, it's funny. The other day I was cleaning out my garage and I found my journal that I went down to the... When I decided I am going to make a movie, I went to the like art supply store and just bought a thing that I could write the rough outline of the film, and I have no idea what I'm doing at all. And so I wrote this... this outline, and it was sort of in three acts, and how it should begin and how it should end. I found it the other day, and it is exactly the Sound City movie, which is pretty funny. I have pictures of it. I couldn't believe it. I took pictures and sent it to everyone. Look, it starts with the 16mm in the Pacific Northwest, and I narrate, and then it gets into the history. And it's the whole thing, you know? And, you know, it's pretty easy to come up with an ending for a movie like Sound City when Paul McCartney's in your movie. You know, you don't want to cash that ticket right out of the gate. You want to sort of save that for the... But we didn't have the final shot in mind when we started making the film. I mean, it's a documentary. Who knows what would happen? So, but it became clear after maybe a few months of working on it. Like, I think this is how it should end. And it's the same when you're making albums. You know, as you're making an album, that inspires you to make an album. Like, a lot of the best Foo Fighters songs have come to us towards the tail end of making a record. You know, a song like Everlong or a song like Times Like These or some those songs came as we were almost finished with the album, and the process inspires you to like do more. And so throughout the Sound City movie, we sort of felt that way. Oh, we have to do this. Oh, now we have to do this. And yeah.
Are you guys surprised by your directorial vision? Well, Dave, you must be, because you didn't know you had,
yeah,
had it in you.
I'm surprised, yes. Shocked.
I'm always confused.
I think we have time for some audience questions now. Okay, we're not using mics, right? Or are we? Oh, you have a mic. Okay, go ahead. We can just wait till she gets the mic to you.
Hi, Dave.
Hi.
Movie's fabulous.
Thank you.
What was your biggest challenge as a first-time filmmaker, and what, if anything, would you do differently looking back?
To me, the biggest challenge was really doing justice to the story of the studio and editing hundreds of hours of legendary musicians talking about beautiful things. You know, each one of those interviews could be a movie of its own, like the conversation with Tom or Neil Young or Trent. They were all really inspiring. And I don't really know what I would do differently, because I don't know if I'll ever do it again. So I'm perfectly happy with the way it's turned out. The first time I watched it, after it had been completed, knowing that I couldn't go back and change the audio on this one thing or change this shot because the snare drum hit is out of sync or that fucking graphic is bugging me. Like, the first time I sat down and watched it knowing it was finished, I actually enjoyed it. Up until then, it was, I haven't slept in a year. I mean, that being said, like, it only took us a year to do this whole thing. You know, we started this 13 months ago, and we were completely independent of anyone. It started with me and my friend Jim, and then I said to Jim, I think this is actually going to be a movie. So he went to his friend John, and then John went to his friend Kenny, and then Kenny went to his friend Jessica, and in total it was about 12 people that worked on this project, and nobody fucked with us. We got to do exactly what we wanted to do, and because of that, and because the vision was so clear, we just went bam, and we did it super fast. And yeah, but I don't know what I would change. I love it so much. Thank you.
Go over here. Yeah.
Hi, guys. Yeah. Okay. We have some questions from Twitter. This one's from Sean. Dave, are you going to continue to make any more films or do music for soundtracks? Or is Sound City going to be the end?
You know, I really think this is the end. I really think that that, you know, everybody knows that music and film go together real nice. But I think that what I learned from the Foo Fighters had a documentary a couple years ago called Back and Forth. And it came out, and our band got huge. Because I think for the first time, people saw us as human beings. They didn't see us as just like, you know, like cartoon characters or a brand or something. Like, wow, these are real people that have like gone to funerals and gone to weddings and really lived together, and the relationships between us. And I think that because of that, it sort of gave this new depth to the music. So a lot of the times when you hear music in your speaker and in your car as you're sitting in traffic, and it might just seem like a sound, but there's so much more to every song and to every artist than just that. And I think that if there were more films that had to do with that with the depth of an artist and their music that people would have a much better appreciation for it, you know. So, you know, 3 or 4 minute long music videos are fun to watch, but if you get the life story of an artist, I guarantee you the next time you hear one of their songs, you'll think of it differently. So, yeah.
Thanks for doing this. Oh, sorry. Thanks for doing these, guys. We really appreciate it. You guys rock. For David Green, you mentioned Stanley Kubrick and David Fincher, but the way you sort of mentioned the approach to this movie, especially George Washington, is more in the reminiscent of the work of Terrence Malick. Is that someone you really dig? That's it.
I dig him, yeah. He makes cool movies. There's a period of time within movies from like the late 60s to, like, you'd look at a movie like Easy Rider, kind of started. What I look at is just a real raw, naturalistic time where filmmaking didn't have to be such a grand studio production with everyone with perfect hair and perfect things to say, but it had that kind of rawness that I really like, and Malick did a lot of that in his earlier movies, and he does now too. I mean, it's beautified a little bit, but it feels like it's of a soulful place, of a non-traditional narrative, and he's kind of just letting things breathe and letting things live and looking at life in a different way, in a non-traditional way. And so him and you know, Robert Altman and so many 60s, 70s filmmakers that I really admire and look to their work as my major influence, just kind of growing up in the 80s and loving the kind of Hollywood 80s movies, but always looking to those for something deeper and richer. And 80s was full of the best popcorn movies ever to live, but the 70s was full of such grit and salt and soul that you just got to love it.
David, you talk about Prince Avalanche being a blend of drama and comedy from both your aspects and former movies. And then you got two actors, one that's very dramatic with, can be comedic, and one that's very comedic that can be dramatic. Was that intentional, or was that just something that came about?
Well, I've been friends with those guys for a real long time. We've always been talking about working together. And when I started thinking about them actually in these roles, I wanted... You know, Paul plays the more dramatic character. I mean, his character is full of heartbreak and sadness and great loss. And Emil's character, who, you know, Emil we know from movies like Into the Wild, and he's always played much more dramatic roles. In fact, yesterday we were watching the movie together, and he's like, it's so surreal watching this because no one's ever laughed at things I've said in a movie before. but he's really, you know, in a strong way, a lot of the comic relief of the movie, because he's just kind of this knucklehead that's just trying to get laid and talking through, like, some of his issues in that way. So he gets a lot of the laughs, and so I think it's really fun for me as a director to try to exercise different muscles of the talent that I'm working with, and my own as well. Like, I don't like to do the same thing over and over, and I always get those itches and those bugs. And if you see some of Paul Rudd's work on stage, you know, he just finished a play with Michael Shannon in New York, and you see some of the dramatic depth that he's capable of. And then you hold that up against some of his romantic comedies, and the fact is the guy's got amazing range. And so if you can kind of take that and peel back some of the layers a little bit and find something really, really juicy, it's a very satisfying thing for himself to see new sides of himself, to make himself vulnerable in ways, and it shows great trust of our collaboration, because he's willing to go out on a limb and not just do what he knows is going to be the crowd pleasing way to go about it, but he's a weird dude like all of us, and he wants to push himself and challenge himself, and Emil too. You know, Emil was afraid to get in a room with Paul because he knows how funny Paul is, and he's trying to improv against one of the masters. But he rises to the occasion, and it was just a kind of a beautiful experience for all of us.
How about in the right here, front row?
This is for Dave. First of all, thank you for Sound City. It was very inspirational on many levels. And I wanted to ask, what are some of the rock and roll films that inspired you as a filmmaker?
Oh, as a filmmaker? What'd you just call me? well, I remember being 10 years old and seeing the Woodstock movie for the first time. And I was totally blown away and inspired to become a musician. Like, oh my God, it just seemed so real and so raw, and just people in a field listening to loud fucking music. It just seemed so great. But when I was about 12 years old, I went to go visit my cousins that lived in Chicago, and my cousin Tracy had become punk rock. And I'd only seen punk rock on like Chips and Quincy and stuff like that. So here I was faced with a real punk rocker, and it was awesome. And she took me upstairs and played me these punk rock records that just changed my life, blew me away, that this was actually real. This wasn't fake. And I went home with this record that was the soundtrack to a documentary called The Decline of Western Civilization, the punk rock years in Los Angeles. It was made by Penelope Spheris. And I hadn't even seen the movie. I just saw the pictures on the record, and they were recordings of these performances that were in the film. And years later, I saw the film, and again, it made you feel like you were there. And she successfully captured the energy of the Germs in a club, and which is next to impossible. It's hard enough just to capture that on tape, but to get that feeling in film, I think, was huge. But that's really what made me want to become, to start a band, because when you're young, it's hard to imagine becoming a musician if you listen to like Rush or Genesis, because they're really fucking good, you know? But then you see another 12-year-old playing in a punk rock band, and you think, oh, I could do that too. And that was a lot of the intention of making the Sound City movie. We wanted people to see even these legends in that vulnerable place of being a human being in the studio, you know, like Stevie Nicks singing her heart out, and then all of a sudden she stops and goes, no, wait, I fucked up, let me do that again. And for people to see, oh, wow, she doesn't sing, you know, it doesn't sound like Landslide every time she opens her mouth, you know? It's like, no, she actually is a person that makes mistakes, and not very often, though, of course. But yeah, I mean, those movies really inspired me a lot.
How about over here? Hey. This is a question for Dave, not related to your film, though, actually.
Yeah.
Yesterday, Lupe Fiasco, actually, I heard, got thrown off stage for... at the inauguration for protesting Obama's war crimes.
Right.
And you've used your platform for very important stunts to expose the Christian fascist right wing. So could you talk about the Westboro? you did!
Westboro Baptist Church.
Yeah. Oh. And how you see why you saw that need and how you saw filling it.
Well, you know, one of the great things about music is that it can serve lots of wonderful purposes. It can help children remember the alphabet. It can help, you know, it's true. The great thing about music is that it goes well with pretty much everything. So in that case, I can't remember why they hated us so much. They hated us because, I had this idea as something I directed, actually. You like this. I thought, well, how come people don't make tour commercials anymore? You know, when Kiss would go on tour in the 70s, you'd see a commercial on television at 10 o'clock, Kiss is coming to the Capitol Center, you know? And so I thought, well, before we go on tour, we should make a tour commercial. And I remembered being on tour once and sitting in like a truck stop diner eating pancakes, and they had showers for the truckers, and there were all these like big burly truckers going in to take showers, and the lady, you'd like pay and get a ticket, and they'd call your number, and then you'd go and take your shower. And so we're sitting around this table, and then they're like, number 42, and like this huge Santa Claus looking guy would go take a shower. But in the background, they were playing Queen's Body Language from their album Hot Space, which honestly just sounds like the soundtrack to a gay porn. And I was sitting there eating my pancakes like, am I the only person that can see what's happening right now? This is awesome. And so I basically made a tour commercial where the four of us are truckers at a diner. We go in and all take a shower together, and there's nudity. You know, it took a day. It cost $170, and And we sold out our entire tour because we put it on YouTube and it was hilarious. Well, the people from the Westboro Baptist Church then hated us because we're gay and you're going to hell. And I thought, and then they were going to come protest our show. And because that whole thing seemed so ludicrous, I just thought, well, wow, why don't we get a flatbed trailer thing, dress up like our characters from the commercial, and go and park in front of them and just play to them, you know? And so we did. And it was great, you know? There's nothing like having someone stare at you and say, you're going to go to hell. And I'm like, I know. Ah, you know? So, so, yes, music is a wonderful thing.
Okay, this guy right here in the red scarf.
Hi, Dave. A friend of mine was a runner at Sound City about the time that you recorded Nevermind.
Right on.
It's as dumpy as you say so in the film.
Yes, it was a total shithole.
So, I was just wondering, were there any musicians who turned you down to appear in the film?
No. There were some tricky ones to get. You know, you can imagine that it's not easy to track all of them down and put them in the same room. But we wanted Pat Benatar so bad, but she couldn't make it. One of the first person we contacted was Neil Young, and we chased him down for a year and then finally found him in Hawaii. But you know, Charles Manson recorded at Sound City. And before he got busted, he was friends with Dennis Wilson from the Beach Boys. And he was also a musician. And so Dennis Wilson said, yeah, here, go make some demos. I'll pay for it. There's this place called Sound City. And so at one point, we had considered maybe talking to him about music. Because how fucking insane would that be? But then, you know, we decided not to because we didn't want the reaction that we just had. We didn't want that to sort of take over the beautiful message of the movie. But, you know, we had considered it.
Hey, we have time for one or two more. Let's go. Sure, in the back.
David, you said you don't like to do reshoots, and I know you don't like to record ADR, like re-record dialogue, for the same reason. Well, how does the music and the scoring process contribute to that kind of momentumist philosophy?
That's a good question. The music, I mean, in all of my movies, I take great pride in the soundtrack of the movie and frequently in the score. For Avalanche, for example, we were shooting it in near about an hour from where we lived in Austin, Texas, and the band and my composer would they'd be on set, so they'd come out, hang out on set, kind of pick up the vibe, go home, jam, give us some demos. We'd edit to those demos. They'd go back and reshape the music to fit picture a little bit. And so it was of all of the movies I've made, it was the dream process because they live blocks away from me. So you just go over to their house and sit down and be like, yeah, a little less this, a little bit more that, and like right when he picks up that, just come in hard with the guitar or whatever. And so you can kind of like go over there, have that quick conversation, grab a cup of coffee, and stroll back to the editing room. So it was really, it was just the brotherhood way to make it, and it was so incredible. And you're working with guys that love movies. Like, I mean, it's when you can find that kind of, again, getting in sync with people that have a great enthusiasm. And one of the things that I think struck me about Dave's movie is that, like, you don't just see the successful guy putting together a bunch of rock star friends. You see a guy that fucking loves music and is geeking out like he's, you know, the 11-year-old putting stamps on the records he's mailing out. You know, you still try to retain as much of that as possible. And sometimes it can get pretty hard because there is a huge business on our shoulders a lot of times that has these great expectations or these amazing fans that support what you do, but they have this great expectation. They don't want you to stray too far from what they love about you, so you shouldn't do that. Go come back over where we like you. You know, so you got all these people to listen to, and your mom's telling you, you should cuss less in your movies because, you know, grandma doesn't like that.
My mom said the same thing. I swear to God. The language.
But if you have that youthful enthusiasm, you do follow yourself in those people. And in this case, it was really a part of, you know, a big part of the reason I even made this movie is because I'd used explosions actually 10 years ago, I'd made a movie called All the Real Girls, and these guys, I just get this CD in the mail. It's like, hey, we're fans of your movie. We just recorded this album. We're Explosions in the Sky. Will you listen to our music, please? And I was just like, yeah, whatever, kids. Put it in. I was like, oh my God, this is like the greatest of the music that I was loving at the time, the Mogwais and the Godspeeds and all these, kind of epic sounds that were coming out at the time. And I was like, these, and they're really young. And I was like, this is amazing. I absolutely want to put them in. And, you know, that just happens one in a million. Usually, I mean, it's rare that you'd even listen to it, you know, because you just get junk mail half the time. But in this case, I was just kind of inspired to listen to it. Put it in the movie, and then you blink, and they're scoring Friday Night Lights, and then I'm like, hey, pretty please, will you do a song for my movie Snow Angels? We can't pay you much, but it'd be really groovy if you'd help. And then in this one, they're like, come on, let's just all, it's all a part of the same voice, it's all a part of our enthusiasm to make stuff, you know? And it's every day. I mean, you can just feel that vibe, and you wake up, and you just want to make stuff, and you want to work, and you want to, you know, create stuff. And again, by getting the people together that make that possible and keep you 11 years old at heart, just makes it that much more fun.
I think do we have any more time for questions? Or I think let's just wrap up on one thought. You guys have talked a little bit, both of you, about the idea of vulnerability. Dave, you talked about it, showing that in your rock star musicians, and David, you talked about it when getting your actors out of their comfort zone. Like, being a rock star and being a filmmaker, we don't think of those as vulnerable positions. Those are cool, badass things to do. So how do you keep, how do you marry the roles that you guys have chosen, the careers you have, with keeping that sense of vulnerability in play?
Well,
easy question to end on.
I mean, I think that if you don't have that feeling, you're in danger in a way, because if, you know, you have to feel exposed in order to capture that sort of, I don't know, that emotion or whatever it is. You know, one of the great things about working in your own environment, in your own independent environment, is that you're not affected by all of the things that might influence you to do something that you wouldn't normally do. So, with the Foo Fighters, you know, we're on our own label and we have our own studio and we write our own records. And when we're done making a record, we hand it to the big record company and we say, okay, we'll license it to you for 6 or 7 years, but then you got to give it back and don't tell us what to do. And they do it. And one of the reasons why we're still a band after 20 years is because they've left us alone. And it's important for people to realize that artists work best when they're allowed to be themselves, when they work with other people or when they collaborate with people that they like to collaborate with. So I think that, you know, it's an easy, when you, there's safety in that place, you know. There's safety where you can be vulnerable. Like in my studio, I don't worry about my family and my band judging me. It's because they just let me sort of do my own thing, you know, and it pays off.
And I would add to that I think there's especially in a world right now where it's so media intense, that there's the burden of failure, that people aren't allowed to fail, or they're expected to be perfect every time, or they're, you know, they've got these great pressure to be a specific something. And I think if you're really afraid to fail and you're afraid to go out on a limb, then you're in great danger, because I think then you get subject to repetition things. But if you surround yourself by people that you are allowed to be exposed to, and you're in an environment that you're allowed to be free. I know in the movie that I have now, there's a whim that I had in the editing room. There's a scene where Paul Rudd's character is walking through a forest, and you know how when lumber companies are going to cut down trees, they tag them with a piece of spray paint, and there's like a little blue line on them. So there's a moment where all the blue lines in the forest, through a camera move, you know, you start and they all look scrambled and abstract through the forest, and then in a camera move, in a very unnatural way, the camera settles into a position where they all line up. And then, for no reason, we write, I love you so much, on top of the trees, as if it's like some sort of ethereal graffiti. And now, it was just something that in the editing room I thought, they line up and there needs to be something said there. It has nothing to do with the movie. It could be totally pretentious. I could be spit on by all of my friends. And some of them just hate it, and other people are just like, whatever it is, it's just you talking to the trees. So just, you got to do it. And I think if you don't have the support, and sometimes that's the infrastructure of a studio or a great financier
or Sundance
behind you, or Sundance. If you're looking at those people to acknowledge a choice like that, they're going to tell you absolutely not. It's a bad idea. But if you're looking just to your brothers and saying, this is just telling me to do it, should I do it? And they, well, you can. You can do whatever you want. And then you do it. And then in 5 years, I may be like, that was the dumbest, lamest thing I ever. but right now, if you're really good, I watched it with the crowd. And I was like, I can't tell what people think of that, but it's super weird and I like it.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, everybody, for coming. You guys, thank you.